All right. Well, I have 7 o'clock, Mary Beth. How about you?
Yep, I do too.
All right. Well, good evening, good morning, or good afternoon, depending on when you might watch this, if you're not here with us tonight. My name is Peter Noonan, and I'm the superintendent of schools here in the city of Falls Church. And it's a great pleasure tonight to share with you, as part of our Parent University Summer Series, an introduction to our new Falls Church City Public Schools Strategic Plan. We have about an hour of time that we've set aside to talk about the strategic plan, and joining me this evening to help support the presentation and do a big portion actually of the presentation is Mary Beth Connolly. And Mary Beth is our new Director of Strategic Planning and Community Engagement. And we're very proud to have her in a new titled role that will focus on implementation and work around the strategic plan. So Mary Beth, welcome. We're glad you're here. And then in the background, we also have Rebecca Sharp, who's our Director of Special Services, Executive Director of Special Services in Falls Church City Public Schools. And she is she's helping run the show tonight. She's kind of our director. So thank you so much for being here, Rebecca. And thanks to all of you that were able to join us in person tonight. We're really, really pleased to welcome you, and excited to engage in some conversation as we move through this. And so I would invite anyone who's on the call, if you have questions along the way that you'd like to ask or raise, feel free to do that. If you raise your hand or write something in the chat, Rebecca Sharp will be monitoring that for us, and we'll kind of inject as necessary to let us know that someone's got their hand up or has a question. But we're hoping that tonight can also be informative, because the new strategic plan is something that we've been working on for nearly a year. So with that, we'll go ahead and get started with the presentation. Rebecca, will you move us to the next slide? Or Mary Beth, I guess. All right. So of course, it is the summertime, and so my doorbell just rang because we ordered supper for our daughter. So hopefully she'll get it. Hang on 1 second. Oh, it never fails. All right. So the strategic plan 22-23 is something we're really excited about. And in that first slide, it did show that we are in the sort of launch phase or getting ready phase during summer of 2022. And one of the things that we like to say during the summer, because a lot of questions come up inevitably about, hey, what do you guys do in the summer? What's the work of the schools in the summer? And what we always say is that we're planning a 10-month party. So if you've ever been a big party planner, you know that it takes a lot of time and energy and effort to make sure that you have everything right. And we're ordering food, and we're ordering transportation, and we're making sure that we have all of our teachers hired and working on strategy and a lot of behind the scenes things. And so this is a big part of the work that we're doing this summer, is getting ready to launch our new strategic plan. So our agenda for the evening, which we're really excited to share, is starting out just sort of, how did we get here? What is some history of the experience that we had here around the strategic plan? Talk a little bit about our mission and our vision, which were modified somewhat in this plan. If you know our former mission and vision, it's similar, but a little bit different. Talk a little bit about what emerged as the core values, our collective commitments, and then the 5 areas of focus that really came through and how we will leverage those 5 areas in the future, and then think about opportunities as well. So how did we get here? And let me start with just a quick
Mohanlal.
Can we have her? Rebecca, I think you can mute people maybe. So how do we get here? So first and foremost, let me back up just a little bit and say that when I arrived in the city of Falls Church several years ago, actually, if you'll go back, Mary Beth, we're not quite there yet. I had an opportunity to engage with the staff very early around what was considered at the time the strategic plan, and it was called the triennial plan. And some of you might have heard that language before, that we were operating with a triennial plan, which essentially was a 3-year plan. And when we sat down and we really looked at it, one of the things that we realized was that that triennial plan was more of a work plan than it was forward-thinking strategy about who we were and what we were about as a school system. So being new at the time, I decided, you know, let's work this plan. And then in the following year, we updated the plan and we tried to make it a little bit more strategic and put some goals around it. And then did put in some progress monitoring steps so that we could see how we were doing on the plan. And then we decided in the second year of the triennial plan that was updated, that the next go around, we were gonna redo the entire plan and come up with a new strategic five-year plan. So here we are today with a new strategic five-year plan that we're really excited about. The other thing, and so now you can go forward, Mary Beth, the other thing that's sort of exciting is that this was the year that we just finished. And you may remember or know that our slogan was Roots, Resilience, and Renewal. And we were very excited about that slogan because it really meant that we were going to go back to our roots. We were going to be a resilient organization and we were going to renew ourselves as we came out of COVID. And we came up with that great slogan of Roots, Resilience, and Renewal about two Aprils ago. And it was about the time that COVID was beginning to decline rapidly. And then the summer came and COVID was back. And it was back in full force because of the new variant. So while we did get back to some of our roots, while we did seem to be resilient, we maybe didn't renew the way that we were hoping to renew, but instead sort of ended up in the place that we felt like emotionally we were from the prior year. So one of the things that I wanted to say is that we're really excited this year to really be thinking about renewal as part of this new strategic five-year plan, because it really, in the end, helps us map out what the future of the system is going to look like. So quickly, before we leave this slide, I did want to share one thing. We've gotten great feedback from about the slogan from this last year, but there were some questions about the icons that went with the word. So roots, everybody understood, you know, big trees have nice roots. Renewal, the idea of finding your North Star and remaining true to your compass was something that everybody sort of understood. But people wondered why was there a deer for resilience? And I don't know if anybody on the call knows, but a white-tailed deer is one of the most resilient creatures in the United States. And when we did seek out the most resilient of those creatures that we could find to use as some sort of icon, we ended up with three choices. Well, really four choices. The first was a tick. The second was a cockroach. The third was a lice, like a nit. And the fourth was a deer, a white-tailed deer. So that made the decision for us because we weren't going to put a tick or lice or a cockroach on our shirts. So anyway, the white-tailed deer represents resilience and we're very excited about that. And that will be a big focus of our work going forward as well. So when we started this work last August, we worked with a group that helped consult with us and move us through the strategic planning process. And I want to give a shout out to Ed Elements and a couple of people with Ed Elements that were really in particular helpful with us were Natalie and also Harvey. And when they came to us and started talking to us about how to put together a strong plan for the future, one of the things they said is you have to have really good engagement with the community, with students, with staff, and the like. And so we set out this time last year, a little bit later than this time last year, to really work towards making sure that we had good, strong participation in this process. And so we had 13 focus groups that ranged in people from community members to staff members to parents to students. And in those focus groups, we had over 200 people participate. We also did a community assessment, and some of you may be familiar or remember back to that community assessment that asked questions like, what are your hopes and desires and dreams for the school system? What are some things we do well? What are some things we can work on? And that community assessment gave us 500 replies. And from there, we also had town hall meeting, a big town hall meeting. It was online, of course, and we had 80 registrants for the town hall meeting. And then lastly, we had 48 volunteers that became part of our project steering and outreach design teams that were fully comprehensive in terms of who was on them with respect to our community. We had students on the committees, we had parents on the committees, we had staff members on the committees, we had administrators on the committees. And in the end, we had over 1,000 people uniquely touching this plan, which we felt really, really good about and really felt like it was a really good reflection of what our community values are, where our community wants us to go as a school system, and sort of a good reinforcement that a lot of the things that we're doing remain strong, you know, because the one thing we didn't want to do in this process, at least the community told us they didn't want us to do, and we understand that, is to throw out what's not broken. And so we have a very strong school system with a great community and great students. And so how do we leverage some of those strengths going forward?
So one of the first things that we discovered, as Peter just said, is that our roots are strong, that there's a strong community. There are many, many employees who want to be here and families that want to be part of this community. So we have strong roots and we have something great to build on. So our plan was not like a brand new garden plan where we had to scrap everything and start over again. As a matter of fact, we have a beautiful, and if you take a look at this picture, we've got all of our schools represented, and the bricks in the background represent all the people that came before us in the last 70 years that Falls Church City Public Schools has existed, because that's really part of our garden. All those traditions that we take advantage of and all the people whose shoulders we stand on. So this is what we heard from the stakeholders in Falls Church. Some of the things they said were, when we talk to employees, they want to belong and they want to be part of strong teams. We heard, and I'm sure this resonates with a lot of you, everybody loves the morning announcements, but everybody is overloaded with information. Falls Church City Public Schools needs to identify and remove barriers to belonging for both students and employees. And we heard from people who felt like they needed better ways to participate and feel like they belong. We heard that social emotional learning is essential to student success, and it matters to parents and to teachers and to students. Students want to see themselves in the curriculum. When we talked to high school students, they talked about different classes where they felt like they were really part of it and other classes where they wanted to see themselves more. So that's one thing we're going to work on. Falls Church is headed in the right direction with our work in diversity and equity, but change is hard and there are changes that we need to make to do that even better. We also heard that employees want professional development because they want to be better at their jobs and they want to be able to advance in their careers. A lot of people know that we have the International Baccalaureate Program, but they don't quite know what it means. So we're going to work on that as well to be able to explain that better. And then the last thing that I'm going to mention right now is that mental health is a big concern for everyone. So that's another topic that this group of 48 people who were our core team then took all this information and had several meetings and worked through different ways. How can we take that information and make some changes? So this is the new Falls Church City Public Schools mission and vision. And those are really important because that is our base. So as you think about how this plan works, there's several different layers to it. And this is the base. This is the most important, our mission and our vision. I'll just read the mission. As the premier international baccalaureate public school division, Falls Church City Public Schools personalizes learning to support each child's unique needs and to prepare every student to be a responsible, caring, and internationally minded citizen. So I'm hoping I can memorize that soon, but for now I have to read it. But the mission and vision are essential to all of the work that we do. From the mission and vision, we started to think about what are the core values? What makes our garden so strong? And the core values, there are five of them. So we believe in a student-centered community, and we feel like we have that. It's very important that everything we do is centered around the needs of students. We believe in responsiveness and accountability. When people have concerns in the community, the school division wants to answer and be accountable. We believe in academic success for all students. We believe in community and connection because school division doesn't exist on its own. It's part of a larger community, and it's really important to connect to all the different aspects of our community. And inclusivity and diversity is also very important in Falls Church City Public Schools. So we took those core values, But then we said, there's more that makes Falls Church strong. So then we have our collective commitments. And this slide is going to break every rule of slides because it's got more words on it than anything I've ever done. But I'm going to put all these collective commitments on one page and just walk through them and read the highlights of them. So the collective commitments that Falls Church City Public Schools makes to the community are that we will hold students at the center of our purpose, culture, learning, and environment. We believe in high quality teaching and learning. We are creating individualized learning environments and small class sizes. For our employees, we want to remain competitive in the region for salaries and benefits. We are providing multi-tiered systems of support for all students to ensure that all, especially those who have been historically disadvantaged, can achieve success. We are focused on the social, emotional learning, and mental health of the whole community. We have a caring and welcoming culture in Falls Church. We believe in being active, compassionate, and lifelong learners, and that's students and adults. We are responsive to current needs. When things arise, we are right there trying to work with the community to solve those problems. And we will actively work to remove systemic barriers to equity in our schools, interrogate and dismantle policies and practices that are at the root of inequity, and provide adults the training they need to foster inclusive environments. So all of those things are the base. So we're building up from the mission to the values to the collective commitments. And this is what the group of people who led all of the planning and steering came up with as the most important things. And the best part about all of this is that this is what we heard from the 1,000 people in the community who got involved. So these are the things that are really valued by this community.
So then it raises the question, right here, Mary Beth? Then it raises the question. So if that's your mission and that's your vision and those are your core values and those are your collective commitments, what are you as a school division going to do about it? So what we have been able to do with the work of these really great committees that came together that we've both spoken about is developed 5 areas of focus. And these areas of focus are essentially the big pathways towards the future for us. So when we think about, and I'll talk about each one in just a second, but I want to run through each of them here for a quick minute, just to say that, you know, based on the information that we heard from the community, we heard that we wanted to remain strong in IB. So for us, one of the big five areas of focus is being an IB-infused teaching and learning organization. The second is that, and this was pre-COVID, during COVID, and really post-COVID as well, is that we want to ensure that all of our community members, whether you're a teacher, a student, or a parent, are practicing good wellness, that we have strong equity practices, and that everyone here feels a sense of belonging. We believe strongly that the community thinks that we should be accountable to our strong resource management. And when we think about resources, we think about the 3 big main resources, which are human capital, financial resources, and then also time. But with that responsibility of being a strong resource management district, we also believe that we should be looking at continuous improvement. And so that means putting together a practice that visits and revisits things that we're doing to determine whether or not they're working. And if they are, how do we enhance them? And if they aren't, how do we either improve them or strategically abandon them? The next is around communication and engagement. We got really great feedback about communication, particularly around the morning announcements. But as Mary Beth indicated, we did get quite a bit of feedback that said people were sort of flooded, that they got so much information that it was hard to understand what was most important. So how do we get better at communication, but also how do we do better engaging our community in a variety of different ways? And then lastly, the investment in our people. You saw one of the last quotes that was on there was, you know, about our staff feeling like they needed good, strong professional development, but we also want to pay people well so that they stay in the City of Falls Church and maintain our small class sizes, because it's that relational component that is so important for our teachers to keep them here. So these 5 pathways are the areas it is intended that any of our initiatives, new initiatives or existing initiatives, should be able to fall under. And if they don't fall under one of these big 5 areas of focus, it gives us a moment to sort of do some reflection and say, all right, is what we're doing actually meeting the spirit of what our goals are for the division? And are we being good fiscal stewards? Because if we're doing things that aren't aligned to the big five focus areas, then we really need to revisit whether we should continue investing in it. So let me take a minute and speak about each one. And we have a Pentagon graphic that we want to share with you tonight that really speaks to the five areas of focus. And I'll just walk around them kind of quickly here. But first is IB-infused teaching and learning. I think everybody on the call knows, but if not, the City of Falls Church Schools is one of seven continuum districts in the country, which means that we offer and provide, we don't just offer, but we provide instruction in international, in the ways of international baccalaureate programming and teaching from grades pre-K all the way through 12. So if you are in pre-K through 10th grade, you are part of the international baccalaureate program, whether you know it or not. And the reason for that is because the international baccalaureate program grades pre-K through 10 really speak to an approach to teaching and an approach to learning that comes with sort of the strategies, if you will, or the areas of emphasis of the international baccalaureate concepts. And so then in 11th and 12th grade, students have an option to continue towards the IB diploma if they want. But if students choose not to do the IB diploma, all of our teachers at the high school still use the IB approaches to learning and approaches to teaching, whether they're teaching 11th grade IB English or regular general ed English. So even if you're not a diploma candidate at the high school, you're still getting the international baccalaureate programs. So this area of emphasis for us is really about ensuring that we provide not only growth and agency within the international baccalaureate program, but we continue to infuse the curriculum and look at best practices that are research-based, that include the global lens or the global context, if you will, so that our educators will provide choice and actively engage students in learning and in service. And that's a big focus area for the International Baccalaureate Program and has been a longstanding focus area of the City of Falls Church Schools. The next side of the Pentagon is about wellness, belonging, equity, and belonging. And as I mentioned before, you know, one thing we knew going into the pandemic and now coming out of the pandemic is that every student needs to continue to feel a sense of belonging in their school. And so and our staff do too, and our parents do as well. So how do we create an environment that nurtures a safe and trusting space where everyone feels like they belong? And so those are some conversations and some work that we'll continue to do now and into the future to ensure that we're prioritizing access to wellness resources, mental health initiatives, and also equitable practices. And this logo, by the way, or this portion of the logo, if you don't know, that's a lotus flower in the middle of a heart. And a lotus flower is sort of typically known for being soothing and associated with yoga or some other type practices where it's very self-reflexive and the like. But the big piece of it is that it's surrounded with a heart. And one thing we really do hope that everyone in the City of Falls Church feels is that we do, as a school system, love our students, love our families, and love our staff. And so we want to also lead with this notion of love and care. The next side is about communications and engagement. One of the things we know and understand is that we must, as an organization, have really great communication with all of our stakeholders. And I would say, on balance, we do a relatively decent job. But we also know that there are a number of people that are missed. And so it's imperative upon us to ensure that we are providing access to communication to everyone. So one thing you may have noticed is that my Friday updates last year started coming out in multiple languages. our website now is offered in multiple languages. So those are really important to us. But the other important component of communication is that it's not just one way, right? And that it actually is two-way communication, because it's important for us to hear from you as parents and students and teachers and constituents across the City of Falls Church about what your hopes, desires, and dreams continue to be for the City of Falls Church schools as well. So we will, as part of this major area of emphasis and focus, look for new and important ways that really empower all of the voices in our community and provide an opportunity to not only just address time-sensitive, critical information, but also share information that is part of our story in our community. I was just reminded that the lotus flower actually represents balance. So it's balance and heart. So then it's investing in our people. And I mentioned that this was really about creating a culture of excellence within our teaching ranks. We are super proud of the staff that we have been able to assemble here in the City of Falls Church over the last several decades. We have teachers that have been here for a long time. We have teachers that have been here for a year. But from top to bottom and bottom to top, we have some of the best instructional employees, some of the best bus drivers, food service workers, daycare workers, you know, technology people, food services, I think. We have tons of people that are just outstanding across the system. And we want to do everything that we can that's within our power, one, to keep them, but also to help them grow in their jobs. We really hope that people, when they come to work, feel like they're making a difference every day. It's about being, you know, efficacious and really feeling like you're making a difference day in and day out. And what we know from the research and from our staff members is if they're getting some support and training and extra opportunities in the areas that they feel passionately about or that they're working in through professional development or professional growth, that they are going to feel like they're making an even bigger difference. And ultimately, what that does, as you feel like you're making a difference, it cultivates an intrinsic motivation and a mutual reliance on the workplace culture and on your work itself. And so we're really excited to continuing to look at new ways to invest in our people. The next is around resource management and continuous improvement. And I mentioned this before, you know, as taxpayers, and I'm a community member here in the City of Falls Church as well, and I'm a taxpayer right along with everybody else who sends their kids to the schools, it's important to me that we are really good fiscal stewards with the resources that we have. And we need to continually look for new ways to improve our instructional and operational systems to ensure that we have great services for students, great services for staff, and great services for the community. We do spend a lot of time documenting what is good resource management and sort of keeping that historical record, making sure that it's accessible and aligned to our priorities. As I mentioned before, it's very important that we spend our money where our priorities are. So everything that goes into the plan going forward must be aligned for it to be funded, as an example. And then that notion of continuous improvement is also incredibly important. I was talking to a member of our staff who's been here for a while, who indicated that in their period of time here in the City of Falls Church, we've never actually done any kind of program evaluation to determine what works and what doesn't. So this coming year, we're developing a process where we will do some program evaluation on some of the programs in the City of Falls Church to make sure that, one, they're achieving what it is that we're trying to achieve, which is increased student achievement and student performance. And two, if it's making a difference, how do we improve on it and make sure that it's funded appropriately? And if it's not making an improvement, how do we either modify it or, as I mentioned before, strategically abandon it so that we can put our resources where they are going to get the most value for our community and for our students in the end? So those are the five areas that are around the Pentagon, and we are very excited. And if you look at it, one of the things you'll notice is that Falls Church City Public Schools, which represents our students, are right in the middle, because everything that we do in the City of Falls Church schools must be directed towards the students that we serve. So I don't remember, let's see. All right, so what happens next? we've got this great plan. We have these five big areas of focus and emphasis. So we now are starting to organize around this plan, because under each of those areas of emphasis, we have very specific projects or very specific engagements that we're going to be doing that will support that kind of work. And so we're starting to organize around those themes now. We're putting together plans to begin launching this year, and also thinking about what are some of those key indicators that will show us that, one, we're either being successful in our process or not being successful, and with timelines and everything else. The next is that the work needs to be done by a lot of people. This plan was developed with over 1,000 people, and this plan needs to be implemented by not maybe as many as 1,000, but certainly a lot more than just Mary Beth Connolly, Rebecca Sharp, and myself. This is a plan for the community and for our schools. And so we are working with our staff in our buildings and community members to identify some folks that would be really useful to help us move forward with this plan, to do some research on some of the things that we're looking at implementing, thinking about planning. So we have some people that are really good at strategic planning in the community, and then ultimately implementing the initiatives that will actually drive change. And as an outcome of that, as those teams come together and are working towards those plans, we will have regular check-ins and updates and provide data on the progress. And that's probably where my biggest role in all of this work happens, is that Mary Beth Connolly and myself and some others are part of the governance of the school system. And in the end, we're those people, along with the school board, that will do these regular check-ins to see, hey, how are we doing towards our progress and towards our goal? At the school level, the strategic plan will now become part of the annual school action plans. So if you didn't know, every one of our schools puts together an annual school action plan. And in previous years, it had been aligned to the triennial plan, and now it will align to the strategic plan. It will also inform the work of the school board. So as the school board is taking up questions around policy, governance, and budget, they will be reliant on the strategic plan as they've adopted it now as part of the governance process for the City of Falls Church Schools. But they will be relying on that plan to help drive decision-making going forward. We will measure our growth in order to identify what's successful and those that aren't. And again, this is a five-year plan. And anytime you have a plan that's 5 years long, it's always subject to change. It's like the art of any plan, right? The plan is only as good as it is on paper until it actually hits the ground. And so when it hits the ground, about 90% of the plan becomes reality and may need to change. But as those things happen, we certainly will be communicating out about it. And we will be providing updates to the community about our progress in our strategic plan. And we're working through a process right now that will likely mirror sort of a dashboard, if you will, that will give a sense of how we're doing in each of those areas of the strategic plan. So you can log in quickly to our website, see, hey, are they making progress on this work around investing in our people, for example? How is that happening? What does it look like? And then if there is an area that you'd like to be involved, you certainly can get in touch, and we'd be happy to have you. So if you want to be involved, just based on kind of what we've talked about tonight so far, is, you know, you can reach out to Mary Beth Connolly. And again, Mary Beth's now the Director of Strategic Planning and Community Engagement, and her contact information is here on the screen, and can get you involved really quickly with our work. So that's where we are. I'm very excited about this. So one of the questions might be, and let me try to game out one question. It's like, all right, so let's say you've got this plan, and one of the five big pass-throughs is, you know, the IB infused teaching and learning. So what does that look like in reality when you're talking about your plan? So right now we have a team of communication folks that are coming together. As Mary Beth said, one of the things one of the things we know is that not everybody understands the IB program completely. So our goal for this year is to really educate the community on what is IB and why is it important for us and why is it important for our students as they move through the system. So that would be one major outcome of this plan, would be an initiative to do a lot of education in the community about the International Baccalaureate program. Another initiative that might fall under IB is we're working on a sustainability academy at the high school. And in that IB infused teaching and learning, one of the things we know is that thinking about sustainability through a global context is really important. So the development of a sustainability academy at our high school might be something that would fall under this strategic plan. The one thing that the strategic, and I'll end here, and then we'll take some questions if you have them, but the one thing that I want to be really clear about within the strategic plan is it's not all new initiatives. In fact, a lot of the work that we're doing is completely aligned to the strategic plan that came out from the people that put it together and from all of the voices that were heard in the community about it. And for those reasons, we're really excited. And an example of that is making sure that we're investing in our people. We've had on our radar for the last 2 years, and unfortunately we haven't been able to do it because of COVID, but the development of a division-wide professional development plan or a learning plan for adults. And so that is going to be one thing that we'll be working on right away that will absolutely dovetail into the plan and also allow us to continue investing in our people. So there are a lot of things that you're going to see that are going to come out, but they'll all be aligned to the strategic plan. So one question might be, well, what's not aligned? What's an example of something that's not aligned to the strategic plan? And I would say one thing that would not be aligned to the strategic plan would be if we decided that we weren't going to follow instructional best practice and implement some sort of plan based on some bad research, for example, or if we decided that we were going to made a conscious decision not to recruit broadly and only recruit in Northern Virginia our teachers. Those would be things that would be misaligned to what the work is that we're trying to accomplish. So anyway, Mary Beth, I'm going to turn it back over to you for any last comments. I'm starting to ramble and I better stop. So I'll let you take us home.
Thanks, Peter. I hope that was really helpful to everyone to learn more about our strategic plan. We are very excited as the work this summer begins, and I've been talking to principals and directors and others in the community about how their work will align with the strategic plan. There's a lot of really great thinking out there. So we are excited to get going. And if you would like to be involved, please contact me and I will get you on the list and keep you apprised of different opportunities to provide feedback or serve on committees.
Great. We got our first question, Mary Beth. I'll read it to you. What would the time commitment for parents or community members be if they wanted to get involved? Thank you, LaGuardia.
Yes, I think it could be as much or as little as you want it to be. So if you really wanted to be on a committee and meeting regularly, we could do that. If you would just like to provide feedback, you can do that as well. So we would match your interests with the needs that we have.
And that's one thing Mary Beth Connolly is masterful at, is she's very good at helping you determine how much you want to give or how much you can give, and then getting you set up for just the right amount.
Right. And depending upon what age your children are, if you have children in the schools, you might want to be involved in the schools that your kids are in, and we would make sure that you're able to do that as well.
And what your strengths are. If you come to us and you say, I really want to do something on research, because I know that you're looking at a few things and I'd love to research certain things, and that's your bailiwick, that would be great. We'd love to have you doing anything that you feel good about.
Yep. Any other questions?
Well, let me say this on behalf of Mary Beth and I, along with Rebecca, is we are so appreciative of having the opportunity to share this plan with those of you that are on the call, and all of you that may be watching this at another time, and really hope that as this plan develops, you'll see yourself in this plan, because it really is something that came from the community, is really focused on student outcomes, on multiple levels, and we're really excited. So Mary Beth and Rebecca, thank you both for helping out. And Mary Beth, great job on the presentation. And thanks. With that, I guess we'll wrap up, right, Mary Beth?
I think we're done. There are four more sessions for Parent University Summer Series. I'm just going to share my screen and them up there real fast.
Yeah. We have four more sessions, and they're really exciting. Some of them are about student, certainly around student focus areas and the like.
All right. Can you see those? Whoops, I didn't put them up yet. There you go. Can you see those?
There we go. All right.
So the next 4 weeks, there will be one session every Wednesday night. So we hope you can join us for those as well.
All right. Thanks, everybody.
Bye-bye. Have a good night.
Have a great night.